Namaste. Welcome to the Ex-Christian Show. In this segment that is called Christianity in Popular Entertainment, I will take you into the world of mainstream cinema and point out the symbolism that filmmakers use to either defend Christianity or to criticize it or just ridicule it or warn against it. These scenes are mostly very subtle, and unless one is a critical viewer, conversant with the Christian ways, one cannot see the symbolism. In this episode, let's look at a clip from the Tom Hardy, Riz Ahmed starrer, Venom. The scene symbolizes the ensnaring tactics that Christianity in general and pastors in particular employ to convert vulnerable people. It's a scene where the character of Carlton Drake, who heads the bioengineering corporation called Life Foundation, persuades his guinea pig Isaac, whom Drake calls Volunteer. Isaac is Life Foundation's first human specimen on whom Drake would experiment his latest finding from outer space. The scene opens with Drake addressing his team.
Thank you all for bringing us to this moment. Our names will be spoken long after we are dust.
Now let me put this in the context of a pastor addressing his flock during a review meeting with his missionaries that have just returned from a missions trip, or after the successful completion of a mega Christian prayer event. Usually these are proselytizing events masquerading as prayer events. They're popularly called crusades in Christianity, making the organizers crusaders for Christ. And the pastor that is addressing the missionary group makes it sound like they go out into the world and proselytize for the good of the people. Symbolically, Drake makes it sound as if he is carrying out these unethical human experiments for the greater good of the planet. Drake signs off his motivational speech to his flock, saying,
"Let's get to work."
It reminds me of a verse in the Bible, in Luke chapter 10, verses 2 and 3. "And he told them, 'The harvest is plentiful and the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves.'" The speaker of this verse, who allegedly is Jesus Christ, is calling the proselytizers as laborers, and the people to be converted, he collectively calls them harvest. What this verse is, he implies that the people that are to be converted are wolves, to whom the lamb-like proselytizers are sent. Isaac is seen being brought in and thrust into a chamber with the door closed behind him. A terrified Isaac tries to look through the glass panel but cannot see anything. Let me compare this with a scene where a potential convert who finds himself in a church atmosphere upon invitation by his friend or a colleague is overwhelmed by the loud music and the unintelligible utterances from the congregational members. Drake calls out to a lost-looking Isaac in a comforting tone.
"There's no need to be frightened, Isaac. There's no need."
Now, this tone and these words are symbolic of a pastor calling out the subject who is trying to make sense of his decision to accept the invitation of his friend to go to church. Drake seizes the opportunity and he says,
"Isaac, you know that's a biblical name?"
Yes, sir.
Nothing could be more endearing than a stranger in an authoritative position calling out your name. It's now time for Drake to land his hammer on Isaac's defenseless psyche.
"God said to Abraham, 'Give me your son, show me you are willing to sacrifice the one thing most precious to you,' and Abraham was willing."
The proselytizing industry is an improvisational theater, and all pastors are performing artists. The pastor's monologue is fashioned in accordance with the culture he is addressing. They know they have but one chance of striking a chord with the subjects. It's a heavily crowded industry with killing competition, and they know it. One pastor's loss is another pastor's gain. A pastor never misses a single emotion that the subject experiences while in his presence. So does Drake. He sees that Isaac almost succumbed to the biblical parallel that Drake just drew. Next, Drake makes a conceited move. He throws himself into the conversation.
"And Abraham was willing. You know what's always impressed me about that story? It isn't Abraham's sacrifice, it's Isaac's."
He knows exactly what Isaac was interested in at this point. By giving what Isaac is asking for, Drake completely conquers Isaac's human spirit. So does the pastor. When he throws himself into the sermon or into a one-on-one conversation with the subject. One of the best ways to appealing to the emotions of the other person is to talk about yourself. A good pastor is also a mentalist who has certain control over the believer's mind. Drake is one too. He delivers a persuasive 30-second speech in which he does to Isaac what the church corporation has been doing to mankind starting 1700 years ago.
Now, I don't know what kind of God would ask that of someone, but it doesn't change anything for me.
Isaac is still the hero of this story. But look around you. Look at the world.
What do you see? War, poverty, a planet on the brink of collapse. I would argue that God has abandoned us.
He didn't keep his end of the bargain, Isaac, so now it's down to you and me to put this right.
Drake seems to have succeeded in etching onto Isaac's mind what I would like to call the Creed of Life Foundation. The creed must read something to the effect: the corporation believes that this planet is war-torn and poverty-stricken, and as a result, is on the brink of collapse. The corporation believes that it has been ordained by the powers that be to be the only hope for mankind. The corporation has risen to the occasion of restoring the planet back to its old glory through the sacrifice of its hand-picked volunteers. The corporation pledges that it won't rest until it has saved the planet. Drake talks of himself as a savior that rose up to make right all the wrongs that God did.
And this time, Isaac, we can.
We will.
This time, I will not abandon us.
Drake puts his hand to the glass panel to establish a physical contact with Isaac. With this, Isaac has completely entered the entrapment that Drake had laid out. The pastor has gained full control over the subject, who now has his eyes closed and is ready to soak in anything that comes from the pastor. This is the moment the pastor and his flock of laborers had worked for. And this is the moment Drake and his team had worked for. Pastors look at themselves as specially ordained by God Himself to carry on the divine task of saving the planet. Most, if not all, believe that the sooner they proselytize the world, the sooner Jesus is going to come to usher in a new age and ultimately take them to a heaven which has golden streets, by the way. Just as Isaac is basking in his newly acquired honor, Drake orders the symbiote to be let out.
Open it.
To the subject under proselytization who might have experienced rejection in love or has faced failure in life in general, this choosing is really big. Just as his subject slips into an ecstatic state, the pastor tells him to repeat a prayer after him. It is called a believer's prayer, which welcomes Jesus into the heart and which gives the Holy Spirit control over the believer's life. The symbiote is then let out. It comes rushing at Isaac and enters his body through his heart. For a split moment, Isaac seems stable and then in a painful process succumbs to the symbiote. Isaac dies. When the potential convert actually becomes a converted Christian, for a while things seem normal. The prosperity sermons that the pastor delivers Sunday after Sunday, the social events he is invited to at church, all those give him a sense of pseudo joy. But inwardly, a transformation begins. A fight between reason and faith arises, in which faith triumphs, killing reason forever. Isaac's death is symbolic of the believer's intellectual death. Remorselessly, Drake calls,
"Bring in the next volunteer."
Indicating that Drake is immune to human pain. Pastors continue to hunt their next subjects, indicating they are immune to reason's death. Thank you for watching. I will come back with another episode. Until then, Namaste.